Right, let's talk about how to make project one. Glossary of form. So I've started off with just a piece of paper. I think it's 18 by 12. And you can see a couple things that I did. First off, I marked vertical lines every 1 inch. And that's basically my guideline for a lot of things as I go forward. So if I have a cube here, 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 it's going to be a lot easier to eyeball in what a true vertical is based off of these than it is to always look to the side of the piece of paper. I also put in my horizon, and I think I put this a little higher up. I put it at 8 inches, I think. I'm going to put some stuff in the sky and some stuff below. You can see like a previous attempt that I was working on. Let's also talk about the tools that I'm using. First off, I'm using this Colorase red pencil, Colorase blue pencil. And these are primarily going to be to do an initial land so that I can make lots of notes to myself and I don't have to worry about going back and fixing that stuff. Then I have a 2H pencil, which is going to be very, very light and hard. And a 2B or a 4B pencil, which is going to be darker and softer. I've also got a black pen, and let's actually just use this right now and mark off my principal vanishing point here, and also my secondary vanishing points. Lastly, I have a little bit of watercolor, so I might just do a general wash, and that way we can start with everything being less than white so that I can use whiteout to add in highlights later. Here's a brush to do that. And I also have just any sort of circular object, which is going to help me cheat when I need to make circles. So, let's start with a direct perfect cube. 2 inches by 2 inches, how about? Well, we'll go three. 3 inches by 3 inches, and I'm going to put it lower than 3 inches below the horizon so that we can see the top of this cube. So right about there. Let's just go. I'm gonna flip this. I generally like to work with my ruler above my pencil so that I can actually guarantee where the pencil lead is rather than where the ruler is. Because the pencil lead's what's gonna end up there anyways. So that's the bottom of my cube. And then 3 inches up. It'll be right here. And 3 inches up. It's gonna be right there. And then we can check how accurate our vertical was, or our horizontal line. So there's our perfect square. And this is going to be going backwards in perspective. Now again, note that the horizon is above this cube, which means that the viewer is taller than it, because the horizon is going to go through anything that is the same height as the viewer, so anything above it is going to be above the horizon. Now, your instinct might be to just emphasize that line, but we want to get the perfect, perfect cube. We want this to be the equivalent of 3 inches going backwards in space. And the way we're going to do that is by cutting diagonals to get a perfect 45 degree angle as if it was going back in space. And then based on that, see that? I cut the diagonal and I have this point now. And based on cutting that diagonal, I'm going to be able to get an exact same distance. Now this is a tricky part. A lot of times, your ruler is longer than your pencil lead, or you don't have enough ruler to draw the straight line. So there's a couple things. First off, you only need one cut diagonal to get the vertical, and then you just have to make sure that this is parallel to your horizon. So I could go like that, and then oftentimes it's good to like double check. Yeah, that looks like around the right vector. So there you go. This is actually how far a cube goes back. And this is going to be a cube that, if it was exactly 3 inches by 3 inches by 3 inches, this point, given these four principal vanishing points and secondary vanishing points, are going to be a perfect perspective. All right, now I can go and use this back edge to cut my back off. So if this line and this line and this line and this line are all parallel to each other, I can just constantly draw lines that are parallel to each other. And where they intersect here on our lines of perspective are going to tell us where this back edge is. And there we go. We have a cube. I'm going to switch over to my blue pencil and use this just to draw the exact correct faces. And that way we're going to be able to differentiate between what's actually part of this cube and, alternatively, what is internal and just part of our guidelines that we don't care about anymore. Cube. I can get. Now if I used this, and just to show you with my red pencil, in the same way that we cut diagonals and we can spot the exact center of this cube now on this side, we could actually cut diagonals on all the sides of this cube. And if I did this, I could use these central pole vectors to know that a sphere would be touching at these exact intersections of the diagonals on every one of these. And then you can draw a perfect sphere where each one of these is connected. Oh yeah, also this top face. However, this sounds pretty awful, right? So let's just cheat. There we are. There's our sphere. So let's just draw some extra rectangles and extra squares. I'm going to draw one more perfect square over here to represent a cylinder. And I want this cylinder to appear as though it's behind this cube. So I'm going to go about 3 inches from here to here. One pencil there. And because a cylinder is going to start inside of a cube, but a circle is sort of also, the radius is always going to be the same place. I'm going to do something like that. Now, I have to make a decision about how tall I want this to be. I think I want it to be tall enough that we can see the perspective distortion, but not so tall that it looks a little cube-like. I want to see the top face of it a little bit. So I just did that to cut the diagonal on this. I'm going to eyeball something that's horizontal to the horizon. I'm going to call that a center point. Let's continue making this cube that's going to contain our cylinder. When you're starting off, you're going to make a lot of the same mistakes over and over. The most common one I find is and I still make this on accident from time to time, is you end up choosing the wrong line to cut, or you might try working back to front, and then it just gets really hard and sad. So now I can cut diagonals on this top one, and this is going to be the exact center of this. Now if I have the exact center of this, I can draw a 1-point perspective line through it, and a line that is parallel to the horizon, parallel to this front edge. Oh, that turned out way bad. This is why you gotta keep your pencil lead real sharp. And this is, in fact, like one of the one places where I'm a little more forgiving of mechanical pencils. So now I have an idea of where our circle is going to go there. You can cut all of these little squares even more. You can just consistently cut diagonals over and over. But I think it's really important to, as a different skill, to just actually be able to eyeball in these ellipses shapes. And don't you know it? This ends up being kind of like almost right on there. And there's our cylinder. All that work just for a cylinder. How about a pointy cone? The cone I'm gonna make behind this cube. And I'll switch back to my red pencil. This is gonna be the same idea as the sphere. Namely, I'm going to try and draw a perfect square sitting here on the ground. And based on that perfect square circle on the ground, that's going to lead in to figuring out where my cone's base is. So there's the base of my cone, right? And this cone, it's going to have its point extend directly above here. So I can just make this as tall or as short as I want. I want it tall enough that I get a good tangent intersecting here. Good tangents are one of those things we're going to cover on the Glossary of Technique. And there's our cone. Okay, so up here in the sky, I'm going to do some 2-point perspective shapes. And That if I keep everything 2-point perspective up here and everything down here, 1-point perspective, a lot of times it just feels a little more organized. But you can totally do a lot of things where you just end up like cutting the corners of this, and then you just get a more interesting mechanical shape. So for our first thing up here, I'm actually going to draw the leading edge of this as opposed to the starting point. And it's hard to keep this in mind because we don't have this constant reminder of it in the same way we do the horizon. The horizon is just an ever-present part of our life, and like so much of our human brain is actually functioning based on our ability to detect it. I'm actually just gonna use my inch marks here. Oh. But you can actually imagine a horizon that goes in the opposite direction. And in the same way that lines repeating along the horizon will always be parallel to it, lines repeating along this fake up and down horizon would as well. So I'm actually going to put a lot of rectangles right next to each other. And this is hard because I can't see the point of perspective way, way, way over there. I can try my best to line this ruler up with it. We'll call that. We'll call that good. Now I'm gonna do the back edges here. I can lengthen some of these and shorten some of them. Now, the further you get to the horizon, the closer you get to the horizon, the closer and closer these things start grouping together, right? And so you're going to hit this point where it just makes more sense to start eyeballing this stuff. I think this is close enough to the horizon that I should just go like that. So what about over here? I'll just put another random cube in. This one I'll make a little lower. This one I'm just gonna go straight for it. There you have it. Cubes at a 45-degree angle in space. So now, how do we go around rendering this? Well, the first thing we can do is decide on a light source. And I always just tend to, it's because I'm left-handed, but a lot of times I just say upper left-hand corner, pointing kind of down. And usually my sphere is the first thing I do for this, but if you just have like a little sphere, if you can only draw two things to figure out how to light a scene, just draw a little three-dimensional cube and a three-dimensional sphere. And that's going to tell you everything you need a lot of times. So I'll start with this sphere. And I'm going to switch over to my darker mediums now. Save my black pen for labeling. So this is my 4B pencil. And I'll start shading this. So if this is coming this way, my shadow is going to come a little bit away from us. Because you can see this light is a little bit towards us, the camera. Ooh, and we can actually have a cast shadow going onto our cylinder like that. Probably a little too much. Now if you're not feeling confident about where you're placing these shadows, eventually you can get pretty good at eyeballing it. And it's not really fun to like set up a little modeling table every time you want to draw. But you can certainly use photo reference. The cylinders. Something like that. Now note that I'm trying to draw in a way that circles the form here. So I'm imagining little circles going all around this this cone, and I'm trying to put my shading in a place that's going to make that a little more emphasized, and it's going to change direction as it goes. Similarly, you can see how this is kind of trying to emphasize that going around there. If I just draw straight lines for this cube, I'm gonna have those lines follow perspective the whole way. Having some pencil lead technical difficulties. So what about these cubes up here? Be pretty dark on the bottom. Although, arguably, they would be darker on this side because this side is facing away from the light. And the underside is too, but it might be getting a little bit of that bounce light on the ground. Let's put in bounce light. You can draw with an eraser. Like that. A lot of times, just through the act of shading and holding your pencil really, really broad to the paper, you can actually sharpen your pencil just by shading with it. Now these are gonna be a combination of two things though. There's gonna be some ambient occlusion or contact shadowing where this touches that one. Anything there? This point, I might try using a little bit of watercolor just to put a big tonal mass in. I think this will actually mess up a lot of stuff because Colorize pencils are water soluble. However, I just want something. Put something in there to make it a little less all over. All over white. I'll just shade it all with pencil. One medium at a time, please. So if I do an overall pass with this. Because of all the darks I laid in, I can hopefully keep this all even in tone. And I'm not going to shade in the sky, so that we do have some differentiation between the floor and the sky. I kind of regret putting that one dot of watercolor in, but I also kind of don't. If you don't forgive yourself for trying things and destroying things and making mistakes, you're never going to learn anything. See how close you can see this, but it's getting sharper the more I do this. Again. This is not the only way to render this. The whole point of the glossary of technique, which is the other part of this, is to hopefully show that there is always a different way that you can render stuff. You could do all of this in pen and ink, you could do this drawing in marker, you could do this in watercolor. Good enough. I'll start before using whiteout. Try using some eraser. I'll go in with white out. You know what? I'll try one more time to make this darker. Let's use charcoal, maybe. Who gives a shit? It's your drawing. Fine. That paper fiber. A little better. There we are. So now it's dark enough that if I draw by erasing, you can see a lot. So now I can put in a rim light. that look pretty decent. Now I can try and add a little more. A little scene. A nice bit of perspective. So at this point, you need to label stuff, right? We can go on with this and say Terminator. Core Shadow. This area, it's reflected light. We have a rim light. Halftone. Highlight. And of course, the cast shadow. Well, that's good to go. Turn it in. Oh, one more. Contact shadow. So as long as you can look for these, there's any number of ways that you can go about trying to make them, you know? You're not beholden to one medium. You're not beholden to one style, but you are beholden to these concepts. Cool. All right. All right, let's do the glossary of technique next.